이스라엘 선교 전문 방송 브레드 TV에서 진행하는 이스라엘 회복 순례 2017년 2월에 또다시 출발합니다. 지난 4년간 매번 봄과 가을에 진행하면서 그동안 많은 경험과 노하우를 축적해오며 이제는 명실상부한 명품 이스라엘 회복 순례로 자리매김을 해온 브레드 TV의 이스라엘 회복 순례에 여러분을 초대합니다. 우선 2017년 2월 1일부터 9일까지 진행하는 올리브 코스는 이스라엘을 처음 방문하는 분들을 위한 코스로 예수님이 태어나신 베들레헴과 예수님이 40일 동안 금식 기도하셨던 유대 광야, 예수님의 품속과도 같은 사역지 갈릴리 호수, 그리고 예수님의 거친 숨소리가 배어있는 예루살렘의 감람산 비아돌로로사, 이런 기본적인 성지도 방문하지만 그것보다도 더 중요한 것은 현재 하나님께서 이스라엘을 통해 어떤 일들을 하고 계신지 확인하는 시간을 가지려고 합니다. 제가 만든 영화 회복의 주인공인 데이빗 오르티즈 목사님 가정 방문과 메시아닉 주 교회를 방문하여 이스라엘에서 예수를 믿는다는 것이 얼마나 힘든 일인지 그들에게서 직접 듣고 그들의 손을 잡고 위로하는 시간을 갖는 아주 특별한 시간을 가지려고 합니다. 매일 아침마다 이스라엘에 관한 강의를 진행하고 또 매일매일 그 현장에서도 특별 강의를 진행하면서 뜨거운 감동과 은혜의 시간이 될 것입니다.
제가 가장 꿈꾸던 곳, 한번 꼭 와보고 싶은 곳, 그리고 그런 곳에 와서 너무 감동을 많이 받았고
너무너무 감사했고요. 은혜 많이 받고 정말 이스라엘에 와서 눈물 없이 기쁨을 채웠어요. 이번에 더 잘 온 것 같아요.
이스라엘을 이미 한번 다녀왔거나 좀 더 색다른 이스라엘에서의 경험을 기대하는 분들을 위해 마련한 무화과 코스는 2월 15일부터 23일까지 진행됩니다. 무화과 코스에서도 역시 기본적인 성지를 방문하기도 하지만 좀 더 이스라엘의 깊숙한 곳을 들여다보기 위해 유대인들이 자주 찾는 재래시장을 방문하여 그들의 삶의 모습을 이해하고 예루살렘과 테라비브의 24시간 기도타워를 방문하여 뜨겁게 이스라엘을 위해서 기도하는 시간을 가지려고 합니다. 뿐만 아니라 네게브 사막의 베두인 텐트에서 하룻밤을 보내며 모닥불을 피워놓고 메시아닉 목사님의 설교와 메시아닉 찬양 가수의 찬양을 듣고 사막의 별을 올려다보는 아주 감동적인 시간을 가지려고 합니다. 특히 이스라엘 회복 순례가 진행되는 내년 2월은 이스라엘에서 꽃이 만발하는 가장 아름답고 가장 여행하기 좋은 시기라고 할 수 있습니다. 이미 수년간 여러 차례 진행해온 프로그램이라 저희는 이스라엘로 언제 가야 하는지 그리고 어떻게 무엇을 보고 경험하며 어떤 시간을 보내는 것이 우리에게나 이스라엘에게나 서로 좋은 시간이 될 것인지 잘 알고 있습니다. 이번에도 역시 그 경험과 노하우를 최대한 활용하려고 합니다. 뿐만 아니라 마음은 간절하고 꼭 가고 싶지만 여행 비용 때문에 고민하고 망설이는 분들을 위해서 하나님께서 정말 귀한 분들을 만나게 해 주셨습니다. 저희 브레드 TV가 춘천 신협과 업무 협약을 맺어서 여러분의 여행 비용을 1년에서 최장 3년까지 나눠서 아주 적은 비용으로 변제해 나갈 수 있게 되었습니다. 물론 이자도 다른 곳에선 상상할 수 없을 만큼의 적은 금액이죠. 춘천 신협이 이렇게 저희와 업무 협약을 하는 데에는 그만큼 저희 브레드 TV를 믿고 신뢰하기 때문입니다. 그러니 이제 여러분은 당장 큰 돈이 없다 하더라도 부담 없이 저희와 함께 이스라엘로 떠날 수 있게 된 것입니다. 여러분, 이제 그만큼 이스라엘은 여러분 앞에 훨씬 더 가깝게 다가왔습니다. 그리고 여러분을 기다리는 이스라엘의 문은 활짝 열려 있습니다. 저는 여러분께 정말 자신 있게 말씀드릴 수 있습니다. 여러분이 이스라엘에 직접 가서 그 땅을 밟아보고 그들을 만나보고 그 현장에서 기도하는 일들은 여러분의 신앙생활에서 가장 소중하고 의미 있는 시간들이 될 것입니다. 그리고 그런 시간이 될 수 있도록 저와 브레드 TV는 최선을 다해 준비하겠습니다. 무조건 이스라엘만 가는 것이 중요한 것이 아닙니다. 가서 무엇을 보느냐, 누구를 만나느냐가 중요한 것이죠. 그리고 더 중요한 것은 누구와 함께 가느냐가 중요합니다. 여러분, 저와 함께 이스라엘로 가시죠. 제가 여러분을 하나님께서 약속하신 땅 이스라엘로 안내하겠습니다.
This week on Jerusalem Dateline, a Christmas and Hanukkah special, we take a look at the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. Could this be the place where Jesus was born? And the gifts of the Magi, what did they really bring to Jesus? Plus, the Festival of Lights, Jesus celebrates Hanukkah. All this and more this week on Jerusalem Dateline. Hello and welcome to this special Hanukkah Christmas edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell, coming to you from the Notre Dame Center, just across the street from the Old City of Jerusalem. During the Christmas season, Christians from around the world visit Bethlehem, the place where Jesus Christ was born. Most of them visit the Church of the Nativity, the traditional site of the birth of Jesus. But after 2,000 years, do people really know where Jesus was born?
It's one of the oldest churches in the world. The Church of the Nativity.
The Church of Nativity was built over this place in 326 when Emperor Constantine decided to declare Christianity as the official religion of the Roman Empire. Since then, pilgrims from all around the world started coming to Bethlehem to visit this place.
Inside the church, the original columns from the 4th century still stand. Constantine's mother, Queen Helena, built the church, but why would she build it here?
We do know that the identification of the site of where Jesus was born already traditionally goes back to the middle of the first century AD at least.
In the first century, the Roman Emperor Hadrian destroyed the town of Bethlehem. After he destroyed the town, Hadrian built a temple and planted a grove of trees over the site where Christian pilgrims had come to honor the place where Jesus was born.
In fact, this temple, instead of destroying the place, preserved the place.
Jerome wrote in 396 AD, "Even amongst those who are strangers to the faith, it is known that inside that grotto, he who is adored and glorified by the Christians was born."
This is the main entrance into the Church of the Nativity. It's called the Door of Humility because you have to bend down in order to get inside the church. It was originally built by the Crusaders and then altered by the Ottomans in order to keep mounted horsemen out of the church.
1,400 years after Queen Helena built the church, Christian pilgrims still come from around the world. The central place lays inside the grotto. Many believe it's the very cave where Jesus was born. A star marks the exact location. Many crowd down the narrow stairs to get inside the cave. Down below, pilgrims often touch the star and record the moment they got to see the birthplace of Jesus. For many, it's a profound emotional and spiritual experience.
What did it mean to be at the birthplace of Jesus?
Something I cannot describe. I mean, everything makes sense and no words. I mean, it's difficult. I'm really surprised.
Now when I open my Bible, as I do each morning when I'm here and I'm reading, well, now I can picture the places.
It's just unbelievable. It's a live stream. Never expected to be here, but it's just awesome.
Father Peter Vasco leads pilgrims to Bethlehem. He says it's especially meaningful during the Christmas season.
I think it's an absolute wonderful occasion for pilgrims to come, especially so close to Christmas, to be here to pray at the spot where Jesus was born and to bring that prayer back in their own lives.
But another significant event took place just outside Bethlehem. Pastor Steve Corey, a local pastor, showed us caves many believe were used by the shepherds on that holy night. Luke 2:8 through 11 says, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord.'"
According to history, shepherds would use these caves to store the sheep during the winter, to store their food in the caves, and also places to live with them. You know, the shepherds were very close to their sheep.
Those shepherds became the first witnesses to the fulfillment of a prophecy given 700 years before, when Isaiah proclaimed, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Today, that Christmas message is still the same for pilgrims, professors, and pastors.
The Bible says that the wise men brought Jesus gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But was the gold really gold? The Bible talks about the balm of Gilead. It was a real plant in the ancient Holy Land, used for medicine, cosmetics, and even for worship in the Jewish temple. It was so precious, it may have been among the gifts the Magi brought Jesus. And now, as Julie Stahl reports, an Israeli farmer is reviving that biblical agriculture, including frankincense and myrrh.
Meet Guy Ehrlich, visionary, farmer, and possible provider of plants needed for incense for a future Third Temple. And that may not be all. Ehrlich says some might even call him a magi, like the wise men that brought gifts to Jesus.
We are at the Balm of Gilead farm. This is the nursery. The vision was to make agriculture of the Balm of Gilead and then to make an industry out of it.
Ehrlich is still in the early stages, but already he's helping turn the desert green on a tract of land near the Dead Sea and Jericho.
Along the years, I built a collection of rare biblical and medical and perfume plants. And I understood that there are some more very interesting plants in my collection that have a huge potential to benefit humanity.
It started with the balsamone tree, better known as the Balm of Gilead. For 1,000 years, ancient Hebrew farmers at the Dead Sea were the only ones in the world known to cultivate this exotic plant, using it for medicinal and cosmetic purposes. Now Ehrlich's biotech venture is reviving that trade and more.
One of the most important medication of the ancient world, a perfume that was considered to be the best perfume in the Roman Empire. It serves as the fifth ingredient of the incense of the Holy Temple. And since the Second Temple period, it serves as the anointing oil of the kings of Israel. At the 6th century, it disappeared from here together with the Jewish people.
Ehrlich got his first plant from a shoot that was smuggled by a German scientist out of Saudi Arabia and brought to Israel. Ehrlich also grows frankincense on his plantation.
This is my second baby after the Balm of Gilead. I started with the vision of bringing back the Balm of Gilead to the shores of the Dead Sea. But after a few years, I understood that I have some other very interesting plants in my collection. And nowadays, I have a team of plants that I want to make into products.
There are more than 20 varieties of frankincense, but this is the one from the Bible, and it's considered an endangered species.
This is the frankincense of the Holy Temple. Now, this tree only grows wild in different countries at the end of Africa, and since there is such a big demand for this, there is overusing of the plant.
Ehrlich is also growing myrrh, and there may be a connection to the gifts the Magi brought Jesus at his birth.
Another way to introduce myself is as a Magi. We know the three Magi that brought Miriam presents. They gave her frankincense and myrrh and gold. Now there is a claim that the gold is the Balm of Gilead because it was more precious than gold. This is the diamond of the incense. This is the diamond of the medical plants.
Ehrlich, who describes himself as a man of faith but not religious, is also growing a number of other plants needed to make the incense for the temple. That has caught the attention of some religious Jews who would like to see a third temple built in Jerusalem.
I definitely didn't thought that I'm going to serve the temple, and I was surprised from the amount of temple fans that came to visit me. When Rabbi Ariel was here, I told him that I'll be more than happy to supply the incense for the temple, and I'll do my best to be ready with the incense till the temple would be here. But I told him that I'm not going to build him a temple.
His goal is to start a research and development center for medical plants that he hopes will benefit the area and the region, and, as the Bible says, make the desert bloom. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Balm of Gilead Farm at the Dead Sea.
Coming up, the story behind the Christmas classic, Handel's Messiah. Welcome back to this special Christmas Hanukkah edition of Jerusalem Dateline. Choirs perform Handel's Messiah around the world at this time of year, but how much is known about the work and the man behind it? Mark Martin traveled to London to learn more about this devout Christian composer and his work that transcends time.
For many, Christmas wouldn't be complete without witnessing or taking part in a performance of Handel's Messiah. From the Virginia Symphony in the U.S. to the heart of the Holy Land, Jerusalem. It is felt across the globe. To learn more about the gifted composer of Messiah, our journey takes us to Europe. German-born George Frederick Handel moved into this house on Brook Street in London, England, in his late 30s. Handel considered himself an opera composer, but public interest was waning in England, and by 1741, a discouraged Handel wondered if retirement was near.
Some people do think that at this point it was kind of like a career crisis, really, and that it's quite possible that he was thinking of returning to Germany.
That's when this man, Charles Jennens, handed him the words or libretto of Messiah. Jennens, a literary scholar, carefully selected Old and New Testament scriptures documenting prophecies about the Messiah, Jesus' birth, death on the cross, and resurrection.
The Christian message is in part also a response to the kind of growing interest in what is known as deism.
Since the deists did not believe in the divinity of Christ, Jennens sought to counter that thinking.
For Jennens, I think Messiah was a very personal passion, a very personal mission. Jennens was a deeply religious man, a very committed Christian.
We find Jennens writing to another friend of his saying, I've done this scripture collection for Handel, and I hope he will expend his best efforts on it so that it becomes his best oratorio, because it's certainly on the best subject. The subject is Messiah.
Here is Handel's composition room, where he is believed to have composed Messiah. He wrote the oratorio in only 24 days. Many believe it was divinely inspired.
Handel reportedly never left his house during those 3 weeks, and a friend who visited discovered him sobbing with intense emotion. After he wrote the Hallelujah Chorus, reports quote him as saying, I did think I did see all heaven before me and the great God himself. For Jennens and Handel, Messiah would be an evangelistic tool to share the gospel with the masses. They even made the controversial decision to perform Messiah in theaters instead of churches to reach a wider audience, including the performers themselves. Handel used secular singer-actresses to perform the solos, such as Susanna Maria Sibber, a woman with an adulterous past, but who is described as being able to penetrate the heart with her voice, when other more skilled vocalists could only reach the ear. Performances were often benefit concerts to help release people from debtor's prison and provide for orphans in London's well-known Foundling Hospital. One scholar wrote, Messiah has fed the hungry, clothed the naked, fostered the orphan more than any other single musical production in this or any country. However, George Frederick Handel did not want the credit. At the end of Messiah, Handel wrote the letters SDG, Soli Deo Gloria, which means, To God alone the glory. Mark Martin, CBN News, London.
Up next, the Festival of Lights. Welcome back. For 8 days, Jewish people all over the world celebrate Hanukkah, a holiday marking a great victory 2,000 years ago. This year, the first Hanukkah candle is lit on Christmas Eve, and the first day of Hanukkah coincides with Christmas. CBN News visited the Old City of Jerusalem to meet one family and take a look at the festive lights.
Thousands of Israelis come to Jerusalem's Old City at Hanukkah to celebrate and see the lights. All over the world, Jews say special prayers, thanking God for miracles past and present, and light a special candelabra or menorah called a Hanukkiah for 8 days.
This is a holiday about spirituality. This is a holiday about values. This is a holiday about connecting to God. So many Israelis come here, everybody's attracted to the light.
Also known as the Feast of Dedication, Hanukkah is not mentioned in the Old Testament, but it is in the New Testament. Now it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter, and Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. CBN News joined Rebecca Spiro and her family for the Jewish celebration.
It's a holiday that celebrates religious freedom and our victory against oppression and our ability to rededicate the temple.
And her children?
The presents and the parties and the latkes.
We have groups coming all the time, and we go on trips, and it's fun, and it's just fun.
In the 2nd century B.C., the Jewish people in Judea revolted against the Syrian Greek conquerors. The Seleucids tried to impose their culture, forcing the Jews to eat pork and forbidding Sabbath observance, Torah reading, and circumcision. Worse still, the Seleucids defiled the Jewish temple in Jerusalem and dedicated it to the Greek god Zeus. Led by a priestly family known as the Maccabees, the Jewish people retook Jerusalem and rededicated the temple. But when they wanted to light the menorah, there was only a tiny bit of sacred olive oil left.
We celebrate the 8 days that the menorah burned, which is a miracle. It was beyond nature, and also the military victory.
Eating fried foods like potato pancakes and jelly donuts is another Hanukkah tradition. Spiro's family and neighbors also have their own personal tradition to build unity between secular and religious Israelis.
We every single year we bring out a table of drinks, and thousands of people come to the Old City for Hanukkah to look around and see the menorahs and light, and then we give out hot drinks to all the people that come.
Spiro says there's a message in the holiday for today.
The world's coming up against Israel. The wolves are circling the sheep. This is nothing new. And the message of Hanukkah is that no matter what happens, our candles burn bright. And like civilizations have come and gone, but the Jewish people are still here.
Up next, how the titles of Messiah became a famous Christmas carol. Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. Christmas is a reminder of the power of Jesus Christ to change lives. One Christmas carol, one of my favorites, sums up that power, O Come, Emmanuel. Here's Claire Fawn from the University of the Holy Land explaining the song and performed by violinist Mari Sklar in Jerusalem's St. Anne's Church.
O Come, Emmanuel is really a beloved hymn. And most people don't realize that this hymn was composed to be an Advent song, not a Christmas carol at all. Each one is based on one of the titles of the Messiah that is found in the Old Testament. O Come, Emmanuel, and Ransom Captive Israel. Emmanuel, of course, is the title given to the Messiah in Isaiah chapter 7, where Isaiah prophesies that a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and will call his name Emmanuel. The Gospel of Matthew applies this very scripture to Jesus at his birth. Another one of the titles applied to the Messiah that was adapted into the song is the Rod of Jesse. O Come, Thou Rod of Jesse, Come. The rod of Jesse is referred to in Isaiah chapter 11. And the rod of Jesse refers, of course, to the kingship, to the ruling. Jesse was the father of David. And so when we sing of the rod of Jesse, we're singing of the descendant of David, the Messiah, Jesus. One of the verses calls for the day spring from on high to arise. O come thou day spring, come and cheer our hearts. The day spring refers to Malachi chapter 4, where we read that the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. This verse does not refer as much to the kingship of the Messiah, but it refers to his tenderness, to his personalness, to his compassion for those who are weary, for those who suffer and toil, for those who are ill, crying out that the day spring, the Son of Righteousness will come with healing, not only for our bodies, but for our hearts, our souls, and our spirits. Many of the titles that are used in the hymn, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, come from the book of Isaiah. Another one is the Key of David. O come, thou Key of David, come and open up the way to our heavenly home. The Key of David comes from Isaiah 22, and it speaks of that opening to passage, to freedom of access that is echoed in the book of Revelation, when Jesus, in the book of Revelation, gives the Key of David, which opens doors that no man can shut. Another very beautiful theme that is touched on in the hymn is when they refer to the Messiah as the Lord of Might. The Lord of Might, of course, comes from Isaiah, when it speaks in Isaiah chapter 11, that upon him will rest the spirit of counsel and wisdom and might and understanding. But the hymn reflects on the Lord of Might as being the one who gives the word of the Lord. On Sinai's height, gave the law. And of course, the word of the Lord is not simply the law, but it's really Jesus himself. Jesus is the word of God. The song, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, is evoking that longing and expectation that we have. We celebrate that Jesus has already come, but we know that something is not yet complete. So it's a very beautiful song because it has an echo of the past, but a tremendous anticipation of that glorious coming when the rod of Jesse, the Key of David, the one who is almighty, God with us, will establish his kingdom on earth. I like to think of Emmanuel, God with me today, God perfectly present, God who brings his salvation at this moment, God who became Jesus, who showed his love for us in laying down his life, who calls me by name, who calls each of us by name, who loves us as a father, who loves us as a shepherd, who loves us as a king. Today he cries out for the salvation of each human being. Today is the day of salvation. We don't have to wait till tomorrow. We can celebrate Emmanuel, God with us today.
That's one of my favorite stories, explained so well by Claire Fawn and performed so wonderfully by Maurice Sklar. Well, that's it for this special Christmas Hanukkah edition of Jerusalem Dateline. To our Christian viewers, Merry Christmas. And to our Jewish viewers, Happy Hanukkah. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.